Good morning. Morning at NTV. My name is David Rukasi, and time for us to get into our Kickstarter conversation. The African Cup of Nations is kicking off today. Yes, we have been waiting for this day for quite some time. For us, the football fans, and the fact that the Premier League, Spanish La Liga, Ligue 1, they're all, you know, they're resting for now. We have been a bit bored. So now that the African Cup of Nations is here, we are very excited, and we are going to be getting into that in our Kickstarter conversation. Today we want to understand everything from the history to where we stand. The last time we were at the African Cup of Nations, we looked like we were all over the place. Is it going to be the same this time around? Our expectations need to be managed as well, because Ugandans, we get very excited, and we need to be managed right from the beginning. We're going to be getting into that conversation, and joining us today is the faces that are quite familiar. I'm almost tempted not to introduce this gentleman because he's always here for Murigwe Mizanyo, Ishmael Dakarachigongo. Good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, NTV viewers. Glad to be here. I always feel like I'm coming home. I'm a pioneer of this show. I was here, and luckily we have someone on the set who was a viewer of the show when I was working here. I don't know whether he still is.
Yes, the viewer of this show, as Ishmael Dakarachigongo was presenting, he was here. You man, don't disorganize us. Is none other than Mujib Kasule. Mujib, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Morning, glad to be here.
You guys have been, you have more knowledge about the Uganda Cranes and Ugandan football. That's why we're having you here today. Mujib Kasule is the director of Proline Sports Academy. Ishmael Dakarachigongo is MP to be, but because the Electoral Commission has told us it's not yet time for talking about people who want to be MPs and ministers and all those regional leaders, we're not going to get into that. But he's a corporate affairs manager, National Council of Sports, and he's also a sports analyst here at NTV. But before we get into this discussion, there is a story that was run by Sam Poza. Let's take a look at that just to get into detail of our Kickstarter conversation today.
The 2019 Africa Cup of Nations kicks off this Friday in Cairo with hosts Egypt taking on Zimbabwe in a Group A encounter. The other Group A game comes up a day later on Saturday with Uganda taking on the Democratic Republic of Congo. It is the second consecutive time that Uganda is participating in the finals after breaking a nearly 40-year decade qualification jinx in 2016. Uganda did not enjoy a happy return to Africa's Showpiece football tournament at Gabon 2017. The Cranes finished bottom in a Group A that also had Egypt, Ghana and Mali. Some of the players that featured at Gabon have been offered a second bite at the Chile. They include goalkeeper and captain Dennis Onyango, reserve goalkeeper Roberto Donkala, defenders Godfrey Walusimbi, Nicholas Wadada, Murishid Juko, Hassan Waswa and Isaac Mleme, midfielders Khalid Awucho, Faruk Mia, Mike Azra, Luaga Chisto and striker Emma Okwi. The rest of the 23-man squad that touched down at Cairo International Airport on Monday evening will play in the tournament for the first time. Frenchman Sebastian Desabli will be hoping to succeed where Michos Rodojevic failed, and his players believe there is no reason for optimism.
Coach picked up the best players from the group, so we are willing to give our best effort. We ask our fans to be behind us after what we did in the last half, but we hope to do much better this season. This AFCON, and we want to do as much as possible to give our best so that we can be able to get out of the group.
We have the quality as a team. We might not have the individuals that other teams have, like the Mosalas, the Bukambus, or the Saido Manes, but we have a team, and you cannot win any game when you are playing individual football. It's a team sport, and we believe that
Well, thank you very much, Sam Poza, for that report. That takes us now deep into our Kickstarter conversation today. If you're just joining us, well, right in time, I'll just do this introduction just one more time. We have Ishmael Dakabachigongo, who is the Corporate Affairs Manager, National Council of Sports. He's also a sports analyst here at NTV and KFM as well. And the other guest is Mr. Kasule Mujib, Director, Proline Sports Academy. Good morning once again. And now let's begin with the Ugandan Cranes, the history. We need to understand the history before we get into, you know, where we are today. I think many times we are confused because we don't understand the history or where we're coming from. We don't understand where we are and we don't understand where we're going. So let me start with you, Ishmael. The history of Ugandan Cranes and especially at the African Cup of Nations.
Thank you, David. And actually, when you started and said this for football people, I don't believe so. I actually think tournaments like this transcend football people. Mm-hmm. And that's what's unique about the World Cup and the Africa Cup of Nations. My mother is in her 60s, and I know she's going to watch a Nations Cup like it's Mugwere playing in it. Yeah. But actually, it's Uganda playing in it, I would say that. But yes, Uganda is going to this for the sixth time.
Okay.
We're very, very strong in the 70s. Played three tournaments in the 70s, actually. It's upon the performance of the national team at the First Nations Cup in the 60s, when Uganda first qualified, that provoked the start of the league. The league actually started to enable players, because at the time, players were picked from around Kampala region and then someone to the national team. History tells us that in the aftermath of a team not performing very well, the people came together and said, you know, we need these players to compete against each other regularly so that they can be able to compete on the African continent. And ever since then, Uganda has been to the Nations Cup 5 times. This is going to be the 6th. And the pinnacle of that was 1978. Uganda got to the final. Actually, in the previous tournaments, the funny thing is that Uganda had not won a game before 78 and had not scored a goal. The first time Uganda went to the Nations Cup and scored a goal, when no one expected them to do so, 1978, Uganda went straight to the final. With, of course, thanks to Philip Omondi's excellence, and then lost to Ghana by 2-0 in that game in Kumasi. And thereafter, it felt as if Uganda would be back at the Nations Cup in 1980 and 82 and 84 and 86 and 88 and 90, but that did not happen until 2017. So it took us 39 years between 1978 and 2017 for Uganda Cranes to qualify again. So I think after 78, Uganda was back in the womb and then came out walking like a baby.
Okay.
It took that long. I don't know what can happen in 39 years. I was trying to ask people who lived, if I had 100 shillings in 1978, and I realized you could buy a piece of land on Kampala Road. But just imagine between 1978 and 2017 how much the world had changed. No social media, probably Obama wasn't born to. He's been president and left in that period. So that's how long a period that we're in the Nations Cup. Now it's become a habit, 2 in a row. Feels good.
Okay. With that history, and now, of course, we're going to take a look at where we are now. You have been part of the Ugandan Cranes setup before. And when you look at the history of the Ugandan Cranes, now we're going to look at the squad. We'll get into the coaches, we'll get into the whole technical bit and everything. But now let's take a look at the squad. Many will say we have had a Uganda Cranes squad that we had more expectations of. When you look back at the days when you played, when you had the likes of Edgar Watson, we have had Ibrahim Sekaja, we have had David Obua, who, you know, these were extremely talented players. These were squads that you would look at on paper and say, this is a squad that should go for the African Cup of Nations. This is a squad that should bring back something. And all throughout these years, we never did. And now we look at squads today, and not to underplay them in any way, you look at them and think, well, if they have made it, well, we shouldn't have as much expectation as we had over the past. What has changed with the squads? Is football getting better on the technical side, or is it individually that because we had individual excellent players, we never excelled as a team?
A combination of many factors. The first one is that the people that played before had more talent in terms of how to play the game.
Yeah.
But at the same time, between 1986 all the way to 2000, Ugandans put a lot of effort in the local league. That's where their love was, that's where their passion was. Yes, they went and supported the national team, but it did not bring them together in terms of looking for a common cause.
Our love was for Express Villa and...
Yes, dominated the leagues. You know, whenever the matches were played, the stadium was full to capacity. People loved and followed their clubs everywhere. So it was their passion. It was their main passion. And because the league does not involve other stakeholders, for instance, the government, there was little support from government because they left it as it was. But fast forward 2005, Dr. Lawrence Mwirinda, when he came on as president, his agenda was to take Uganda back to the Africa Cup of Nations. And he made it clear to the nation, and people started to dream now.
Yeah.
He rallied everybody, including the sponsors, the fans, and people started to say, okay, now this is our main agenda. Since then, Uganda has been trying to fight to get in. So many close calls and near misses, and finally we made it. Then we started to see corporate sponsors coming back to join, the likes of MTN, now Airtel. At the moment, Uganda Cranes has 6 multinational companies. On top of that, the government has fully come behind this team, and they have looked after it. They have given them everything they need, and they've supported
all the backing.
Yes.
Before we get into that money issue, there's a point where you say that the local leagues were excelling, but Uganda Cranes was not.
Yes.
And many people would say when the local leagues are doing well, the national team should be doing even better because it's a collection of what is happening with the local leagues.
Yes.
Well, besides the support from government and fans and all that, football should be played at the end of the day.
Exactly.
So if the local leagues are doing well, the national team should be doing well, because at the end of the day, it's football that will get you to the African Cup of Nations, not the finances.
Yeah, but it does not particularly work like that, because if that was the case, England would be winning the World Cup every time, because it's the best league in the world.
And the guys in Spain will beg to differ. But
statistics speak for themselves.
Yeah.
4 English clubs were in the final two major trophies recently. But in those days, you know, there are other factors. I was coming to the technical factors. Back then, like I said, there was a lot of talent. And to other nations, the national team was as important as even the league, or even more. They had players that were playing in Europe way before we had anybody crossing the border even to play in Kenya. The gap between the big countries in terms of football and the so-called small countries like ours at the time was so huge. When we played Egypt, it was a foregone conclusion that we either concede 5 or more. So some of us who played against it in those days, we went for damage limitation. But if you see now, the gap between the so-called giants of football on the African continent and the rest of the continent is narrowing every day. First, because the talent is reducing, but secondly, the knowledge and the information, now people are doing almost the same things. Football has become standardized, and that's why you see now every match is a close call. The reason why I talked about the national cause before, when it came to the national team, there were days, for instance, there's a time when Uganda Cranes had a qualifier, very important qualifier, but Sports Club Villa, because of an issue with the league, refused their players to go and play for Uganda Cranes, and it was okay.
Wow.
They didn't go. The likes of Maginu C, Paul Hasule, the cream of Cranes played for Villa then, but they stopped them, and it was not even an issue. But if it happened today,
wow,
everybody would, yes, you know, will jump in. Yeah. So that shows you the importance people attach to the national team then. Yeah. But right now, it's everybody's calls and everybody's pushing the same direction. We're having now players who are playing outside Uganda. They're a bit more exposed. They are being coached better. They're in better leagues, better environment, well facilitated. And it's the same with every other team on the continent. So that has narrowed the gap. And that has helped now us, Uganda. Because when you dream and you put all the effort in the dream, chances are you will get it. So when we dreamt about this Africa Cup of Nations and it became the main agenda of Uganda football, and it is still now. Everybody cranes, qualification. So we are getting there. And that's why you see now the boys are confident going there for the second time, and they believe they'll put up a good show. Many Ugandans are believing and hoping as well.
I'm going to stick with you just for a second, because now we're talking about, we have looked at the history. We have looked at where we are now when we compare the squads that we have now to that we had in the history. Now, let's take a look at the technical beat of the Uganda Cranes. Now, we are technically better as a squad. When you look at the players that have been selected for this African Cup of Nations, you look at, now we're going back-to-back, last time around as well, and you look at the past squads where clearly talent was more with the past squads. When you look at the squad that has been selected today, is it a representation of the best players that we have in the country, or the best players that can deliver at the African Cup of Nations, or the best players that are known or are picked? Because we have had those incidents where Ishmael, he have had him very many times complaining, him and Elvis Senono, complaining on why this player has been picked and this one has been dropped and this one has not been taken, and how there is politics that comes into play. We all remember the time of Mulindwa when he was president. There are certain players that you just have to pick from. Then it was called what?
I almost want to fight you. I'm a bit of a realist.
Yes.
I don't want to take Kasule's time. Is that I'm a bit of a realist, because unlike many Ugandans who have preference of who should be playing, many times when teams are picked, I look at what the coach thinks, and I think I have the ability over time to understand what the coach wants. That's why I cannot make arguments for form. Hopefully Kasule will, for Juma Balinya and a few others. I don't make those kind of arguments, because I really understand what coaches want. Actually, I'm normally able, when I'm watching a game, to say this is what the coach is going to do next,
because
I've dedicated my life in journalism and analysis to just understand what the coach wants of every particular player. So
okay.
I'm not one of those who have too many qualms when selections are made. And he's been a coach before. I've had a go at him before. About some of his selections. Not many of them have been excellent, but he has the microphone.
Let's take a look at the squad that has been selected. Now, when you look at it, of course, you are very invested in the league. You watch many of these games. You have been a coach in the local league. When you look at the players that have been selected now, he says, well, an argument for form, or, you know, players that can feel the tactics, because we have had this discussion on Sarri and Chelsea and how some players don't fit into, you know, his philosophy and all that. When you look at the squad, and before we get to the discussion with the coach, what do you see?
Yeah, I think, like you put it, it is the squad that the coach thinks will deliver. He's not looking at talent, he's not looking at form, he's looking at the people that he thinks that he will deliver. Because in the tournament like this, you go for results. He wants to get out of the group stages, he wants to go as far as he can. So he selected players that he thinks can do the job. Not necessarily the most talented or the most informed player, but the ones that he thinks that will deliver the job. And I think it is representative of the players that are in camp now.
Okay. Ishmael, now let's get to the coach. We have had a number of coaches at the Uganda Cranes setup. Recently, I think the man that came the closest, he had a very good connection with us Ugandans locally. But I think it's
over time. Because David, you have to go back when Mitchell was first appointed.
Yes.
In 2013, there was this public outcry about how poor a coach he was, expelled from Rwanda, and then there was this cry about how bad a coach was. I know Kasule was part of a team that actually recruited Mitchell at the time was working with FUFA. And I remember going on a tirade all over radio and defending Mitchell like I was going to earn a penny. And he never gave me a penny his entire life I just spent here.
We're not sure about
that. Yeah, because I felt, because the thing at the time, I thought Mitchell understood Ugandan football. And one of the other things is that Mitchell would do the things that would make us win, because we are largely an ultra-defensive side because we do not have the exceptional individual talents. Like, and I don't want to come here and start reminiscing and sounding very nostalgic and use Jackson Mayanjo, Stephen Bogere. Probably 90% of people watching this television show do not relate to those people at all.
I think the earliest we could go is David Oboah.
Yeah, that's the farthest many of the people watching this TV show would. And I don't want to strain their minds and send them onto Google, because most of these videos may not be there. But yes, I think every coach has to be different. I was one of the lucky journalists when Sobhasindo Sabri had just come to this job. I was one of the first people to interview him, and I could almost understand he was ready for whatever I was going to face in Uganda. I think many of us wanted, at this point, for that transition from the Mitchell football, the ultra defensive football, to the attack,
and a more expressive
brand of football, which I can say so far, the Sabri hasn't delivered. Right. You can see there's been a bit of effort sometimes with the kind of selection he's made, especially I think the game against Lesotho, when he had to pick Alan Katerega and me, and had a lot of attacking players on the team, on the pitch at the same time, and you could tell there's something different. But I think that's one of the lesser games. In the end, a national team coach, a national team managerial job, it's result oriented. Yeah. There's no time to build. The longest I think he's been with this squad in his life is the past 3 weeks. It's a 5-day job. Yeah. And you've got to go with your instincts and what the players do best. And what do we have in Uganda currently? A lot of good defensive players. Put numbers behind the ball, and that's what he's going to do.
Mujib Kasule, while he was talking, mentioned the fact that I don't want to say we have less talent, but the players we have today are not as talented as the players we have had before. Does that become even harder for a coach to transform the team from the Mitchell kind of defensive play into getting a team that is more expressive? Because you can only have a more expressive team if you have players that are willing to express themselves.
I think it's a challenge, and it's a challenge, I think, about the structure of Ugandan football. We all want to start the building with the national team. And this is something I know it is with Kasule's team, Proline. They've tried to do that. They play that expressive kind of football. And they've tried to do it for a very, very long time, for over 10 years. And the challenge with Ugandan football is that most of the time we want all this to start with Uganda, and it shouldn't start there. I think this goes back to what FUFA teaches the coaches and what they demand of these coaches doing at their clubs. Over time, that's where the transformation will come. Because, David, it's unrealistic for a coach to come here from France like Dosabri does, and you want him to be the one who delivers that brand of football. In the end, he needs results. He has a contract. And maybe if this is just a walkway, if Uganda is a walkway where he's thinking of taking a better job, that better job will only come if Uganda do well. But Uganda may not do well by playing that expressive football.
Ishmael, when we talk about expressive football, we know at some point Express was called Kawoo FC. Mm-hmm. We know KCCA, their manager Mike Mutebi, is one that loves that expressive football. Mujib here as well with his Proline squad. We're not sure about what kind of football he's played at Vice as yet. Is it expressive or not? We won't get into that conversation. But then at least we have three teams in the local league that are trying to play expressive football. So how hard is it for us? Let's add Police to that.
Police, that's who play the best football in the league, actually.
So how hard is it for us to build on that? If you are a coach and you're looking to get the national team to play expressive football, then all you have to do is go to these four teams and pick your core of the national team from this squad.
The challenge is, and this is something you mentioned earlier, most of these players do not play here. They have not been educated in the current setup. 14 of these players were the last AFCON. 23? 18 of these do not play here, and most of them maybe do not have the education that is ongoing at some of these clubs. But in the end, for me, football is so result-oriented. You've got to feel for coaches who are trying to build anywhere in the world. I feel for them actually most of the time, because no one is going to accord them that time, that kind of time. In the end, when the Cranes walk out tomorrow, we all want a result against DRC. Whether we get it is a totally different matter. Actually, no one will care if Uganda go out and beat DRC. If it meant 11 players behind the ball and then that one corner kick and Patrick Kadu bundles it over the line, we won't care how it went in. Probably the best expression of football has got to be the opening game of the World Cup in 2002, Senegal against France. I don't remember what Senegal did in that game.
But you all remember Senegal winning.
Yeah, Papa Bouba Diop just pushing the ball over the line.
Yes.
After France had done all the playing, and then Bouba Diop buries that, and that was it.
Okay.
So, in the end, it's so resulted. I can probably make an excuse for coaches who fail to build anything at club level, but national team, never.
Mujib, politics has kind of crowded Ugandan football for a very long time. I don't want to mention names in here, but politics has always had its play. Right now, it looks like there is less of politics. Looks like, I'm going to use that. Looks like, because when I say looks like, it could be because now it's not more in the public.
And you're talking to a former presidential candidate. Aspirant.
So, has politics played in our favor or against us? And is it at play now that we have just decided, Mujib has just decided, okay, let me side with the Uganda Cranes, let me keep quiet for once? Has Ishmael Dakauchu, he's also very political meanwhile in his statements, though he finds a very nice way of saying things that you think he's not chosen sides. I remember one time, I got shocked one time when I walked into Mujib Kasule coming up for KFM Sports, and Ishmael was there, because I had listened to the show the weekend before, and Ishmael was going at Mujib Kasule. I was like, okay.
We have those differences.
But yes, politics and football.
Yeah, for a long time, of course, there's been a lot of politicking in the game. It continues to be there, but now I think people are learning to separate when the time for politics is and then when time for football is. As we speak now, it will be unthinkable for somebody to start playing politics, especially around the national team, because the national team does not belong to any particular individual. It's for all Ugandans. That's why when the squads come out, every Ugandan has a right to talk about the squads in his own view and giving his own opinion, what he thinks, the players, who was in, who was out. Everybody has a right when it comes to that. But we just have to remember that we have only one coach. At the end of the day, give your opinions, but keep the respect. But the politics now, as you rightly put it, doesn't seem to be a factor anymore. Before, national teams would be in a camp and other people fighting them. You know, Ukraine is supposed to fly out. They have a court in case. They have a case in court, you know, but for now, every Ugandan is behind this team and is behind the cause. They've put the politics aside and supporting the players. Just to chip in on the earlier question, actually, all the players in the Uganda camp, now, where they actually got their football education here. Mm. The football education phase is between 12 years and 16 years. But the question is,
I'm not sure, was it the right education?
That's the key question. What kind of education are we giving our players at that stage? Because that's the crucial stage. Do we even know that is the crucial stage? Sure. But that is something that we can look at in totality after the tournament when you are reviewing this and that. And also, I think Ugandans, as Uganda, we need to have a football philosophy. At the moment, we don't have one. We need to have a philosophy so that we know, when you talk about Egypt, you know the kind of football they play. You even know the system. And they play this system for over 30 years, and they continue
to develop. It's just about finding players to fit into the system.
Yes, the players make the system, but the philosophy comes from what do we want as a nation? What kind of football do we enjoy? And it's clear that Ugandans now are thirsty for that kind of attractive expression football. Yes, Ugandans will not care how we win tomorrow. We will get the results. But there are those football purists, and there are many in Uganda who like to win the right way. I know so many fans that support Manchester United. And during Mourinho's time, United was winning matches and they were saying,
no, this is the kind of football.
So now the world, when it comes to football, is more exposed now. They know what they want. They know what they like. So that is the direction.
These days, you find border people talking about technical abilities.
Exactly. They will call you. A fan will stop you and argue with you about a system, and you're a coach. You see, and you wonder how knowledgeable they are. Because now, there's a lot of knowledge out there. There's a lot of interest out there. There are people who are betting. These people have information about clubs and players that I don't even have.
And actually, David and Mujib, is that one of the other things that sport is entertainment. When someone goes into a stadium and they are not entertained, that's one of the reasons why we demand this kind of football, because we have so much that we go through in the rigors of life to put food on the table and everything else. So by the time I come to a stadium, I sit in front of my television station, it's a bit like listening to Mariah Carey with a high-pitched voice.
Yeah.
And if that high-pitched voice is not there, then it's a waste.
Yeah.
That's why football managers are demanded of so many things today that they weren't before.
I think Arsenal fans do understand that more than anyone, because for them it's not results, but the football played on the pitch is quite expressive enough. Mujib, now we have looked at the history, we've looked at the coaches, we have looked at the squads. There is one question that we never get into, because overall, even now more than ever, when you look at the Premier League clubs, when you look at international teams, the coach is one person, the squad is the other. But now we're looking at the coaching team. That's one bit that many people many times don't take that much thought into. Here in Uganda, we have had a time where we kept on saying it is not Disabre picking the players. It is his trusted team that is picking the players. When you look at this coaching team, do we have the right people in there? Who are these people, and are they the right people to help the coach to get this squad to where they need to be? Because it's very important. And Arsenal will tell you that they had problems. Players were getting injured, and they kept on wondering, why are players consistently getting injured? We have players who fail to perform. I don't know why I keep referring to Arsenal. The man who is in charge of performance at Arsenal just got fired, because suddenly when it came to the Europa League, players' performance went down and he had it. Do we have that kind of setup with the Uganda Cranes to help support the squad and the coach?
Yeah, I think you can only judge them by their achievements. The team managed to qualify in a spectacular way throughout the group, so it means they are doing something good. Personally, I think when you look at the international standards now, that coaching staff is even supposed to be bigger than it is. But I think because of the resource envelope...
bigger and appointed by the head coach.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's supposed to be bigger with everybody specialized in a certain area. At the moment, the resources don't seem to allow us to have more than one assistant coach, because we have one assistant coach, so we could have three, then departments and everything. But I think so far they are doing a great job. They are doing a good job, because as far as we needed was to qualify, and they did that in a spectacular way. Could it improve? Yes, it could. But the other issue is that it's better when the coach is appointed, then he appoints
or he comes with his team.
Yes. But as Uganda, we can't afford. Because when you appoint somebody from France, he will have to bring seven people from France, and you can't afford.
Yes.
Actually, he's forced two of his people onto the team.
Those are seven apartments in Lubo.
Exactly.
And cars.
Seven
five-figure salaries, all of them in dollars.
Exactly. Wow. And then schools for the kids and so much. But Disabre has forced two of his people, the fitness trainer and somebody else, onto the team.
The video analyst.
Yes. So I think the technical team is beefed up enough with those two inclusions. So I think so far they have done a great job in as far as how much they could do. I think they are doing a lot in terms of what they have at their exposure. Because like you said, even Onyango mentioned it in his clip. He said, we don't have individual good players, but now we have a team. We work together.
Yeah.
We suffer together.
Okay.
For
our best player right now, and I was saying it earlier on when the speaker Rebecca Kadaga was talking about the Uganda Cranes, she kept on mentioning Dennis Onyango, which clearly tells you that's our best player.
By far, he's the only one that will get into.
If our best player is in goal, that tells you, I think, a lot about the squad.
Yes.
but let's leave that. Mushibu, we have to let you go. But before we let you go, two things. Chap. One, the budget. $2.4 million for the Uganda Cranes. Ishmael will have his say a little bit later, but because you have limited time. What's your take on that money? $2.4 million.
I think I should thank the people who are supporting Cranes. 2.4, looking at where we've come from, that's a lot of money for us to be able to look after this team and maybe make sure that we achieve what we want.
Hopefully we're not going to have those incidents of players being asked to pay for their jerseys. Like, I think
of course that would be a shame, because this money was against the budget.
Yeah.
That FUFA gave to National Council Sports to forward to government.
Okay.
So when the money was put in place, all those things were catered for, and we do not expect issues. But you know, with Africa, you see, Ghana went to the World Cup and they were playing so well and doing well. All of a sudden, they started fighting for money. Yeah. You know, people played with their money in socks other than
it had to be flown to Brazil. Before that, in 2006, Togo refused to go to training
at the Bayern company.
The Bayern company, and actually FIFA had to go to the hotel where they were staying in Munich and paid money from FIFA coffers. Yesterday, Zimbabwe refused to train.
Yes.
They have a game today, actually, against Egypt. They refused
to train. How I wish we started with those ones that
have refused to train. They are owed money by their FA, and I think the same has happened with Cameroon.
Mm.
In Nigeria, it's daily bread. Mm. It's happened so many times. So
this is a man from National Council of Sports, so the reason why we are having less of him talk about this money.
Yes. Actually, when council is able to source this money from the Minister of Finance, it's handed over to FUFA to handle.
No, don't worry, you're already protected.
Exactly.
You're fighting a battle that they haven't put in front of viewers yet. But I know when it comes to money and Ugandan football, it's something that you want to distance yourself from,
yeah,
and
course.
You want to be very clear. Okay. Lastly, Mujib. Our chances at the African Cup of Nations, looking at the past tournament and looking at the squad that we have now, you look at our group, when you look at the group that we have at African Cup of Nations, we have, unfortunately, we are in that group that has Egypt, who are the hosts. I think they have hosted it 5 times, managed to win it 3, and at the finals once, which tells you that it's a hard group. But when you look at that group, when you look at the Uganda Cranes, our chances this time around.
I think
be sure to manage our expectations as Ugandans. You know how they can be.
No, I think in this group we have an equal chance between ourselves, DRC and Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
Of course, Egypt
and the top dogs.
At top dogs, and this is because they're at home.
Yeah.
If they were not at home, we played Egypt 3 times in the last 3 years, you know, and all those matches have been close, one-nil margins. So I say the cup has really narrowed. In these days, it's impossible to decide a game before it is actually played. It's very difficult. But when you look at the way we qualified, all four of us, Zimbabwe and Congo were actually in the same group, and these people canceled each other out.
Actually, Zimbabwe won in Kinshasa.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So, Congo, in the past, they have a lot of experience and they have good players, but in recent times, they are not as good as they were in the past. So, we have a chance against them, we have a chance against Zimbabwe. And that's how it's going to pan out. How do you perform in your very first game?
Okay.
Then it gives you momentum, and before you know, you have the points, because 4 points in this group will be good enough for somebody to go through. So yes, we also have good experience in terms of people who have taken long on the national team. We are out there with Congo in this very group because we have more experience than even Egypt in terms of players that have been on the national team for a long time, because this Egyptian team is a young team. 14 of our players were there before, so you think that the nerves have gone down a bit. So we have the experience, we have the teamwork that we are going to rely on. Maybe we can think about
Ismail. I still have you here, so I'm going to hold you for a bit, please. Understand. The last question, because many times there are people out there, like Ismail was telling you, Ugandans have a lot of knowledge with football these days, and a lot of interest and a lot of passion. If you were to predict the Uganda Cranes' success at this African Cup of Nations, how far would you push them?
Push them to 4 points, getting a draw against Congo and beating Zimbabwe.
Okay.
And hopefully Egypt beats all the others for us, and then we can go out of the group. That's the best scenario I see.
And then after that, it will be a case of who we face.
After that, we won't ask so much from the boys, but in the group stages, I think they can get 4 points.
That's very interesting. Thank you very much, Mujib Kasule, for joining us this morning. Mr. Mujib Kasule, Director of Proline Sports Academy, we are looking forward. One time we have to get you in here so that we can understand. We have had this discussion briefly about having a sort of a consensus around the table on where to go forward when it comes to Ugandan football. Seem not to have a direction, but very many agencies and in this country we seem not to have a direction, but hopefully we can have that discussion on the direction that Ugandan football needs to take. Do we have one? Should we create one? Who should create it? And what direction should it be? We look forward to having that discussion, and we'll definitely have you here, and you can help with that discussion. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you. The guys that are watching, I can see some of the response that is coming through. We're going to get into that in a bit. We're going to, the man from National Council of Sports, who has already distanced himself from the fans, is going to be here in the next half and is going to help us understand a little bit more on the money, when it's given out, where does it go? When they say $2.4 million, do they deposit on Mr. Magogo's account? Does it go? No. We are going to get into the details. But right about now, let's link to Stephen Bide, who is at Old Kampala, just to give us a quick traffic update, and then we'll get back and have Ismail Dakaba Chigongo defend himself more. Stephen, good morning.
I'm right here at Old Kampala, and I'm standing at the entrance of the Uganda Muslim Supreme Council. That is on my left, and on my right is Old Kampala Senior Secondary School. Behind me is